here today, and I just think it's a beautiful day outside today. And I know it's a little chilly, but winter really hasn't gotten here. And I went out and sat in the trees on Friday, and it was going out. And let's see, we have some announcements to begin with. First of all, is that one up and going?
We're back.
They're back now? All right. So we had a little glitch in our camera, so I'm glad I didn't want to make this announcement first, without them both going. But I want you to mark your calendars, as we are going to have an online Christmas Eve service, and that Christmas Eve service will be at 5 o'clock. And so please mark your calendars, and it'll be an online. We're going to adhere to what our conference is suggesting for all our churches. And just mark your calendar and the time that our Christmas Eve service will be at 5 o'clock. Please tune in for that. We will be doing Facebook Live on both for TEFT and NIMIN at that time. And we are going to have a Christmas Eve service. And we're trying to plan some things, so we're going to be working on that. So some special music, and we're going to have some today. Frank is going to share a song. So let's see, that's coming there. This is the fourth Sunday of Advent. And so let us all be prepared. Let's say there was another one. Just going to the birthdays. We have some birthdays this week. Happy birthday to Karen Froman and Emerald Barbie. They have a birthday today. And while I'm doing that, I want to share a card with all of TEFT that Karen had sent. And she said the best gifts are the beautiful people who touch our lives. And then she kind of changed up the inside a little bit to apply to them. But said at Christmas, we are feeling especially thankful for the gift of all of you. Wishing you a holiday filled with everything merry and bright. Love, Gary and Karen. And a note for everyone is that we are doing well and hope everyone there is the same. So that's a card from Gary and Karen to all of us, the church. So thank you to her. And so we have a few birthdays this week. And as I said, Karen Froman and Emerald Barbie have one today. Norm Bird has one on Tuesday. On Friday, Carol Deerdorf has a birthday. And Saturday, Haley Garlock has a birthday. So happy birthday to all them. We're saying happy birthday to them. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear friends. Happy birthday to you. So happy birthday to all of them. And also we have an anniversary coming up, and that's tomorrow. David and Trisha Myers have the anniversary. And so I think you said how many years?
32.
32 years, man.
Must have been a baby.
So happy anniversary to them. We'll sing happy anniversary. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary, dear friend. Happy anniversary to you. 32 years. Wow. Yeah,
I could only drink punch on my wedding night.
Oh, is that it?
Wasn't old enough.
Yeah, wasn't old enough. I don't know, you don't look old enough now to me. That just means I'm getting older. So that's so anyway, I think that's all of our announcements, unless anybody has any that they can think of.
Youth group.
At NIMIN will be meeting this Wednesday. That will be at 6 o'clock. So anybody that's watching, please spread the word to the kids. And so we will be having that. And we're kind of do some decorations, Christmas tree ornaments and that kind of thing, and just kind of get together and a little Christmas party for the kids before the end of the year, especially because of the fact that we can't meet on, have our New Year's party. So keep that in mind. Mark the calendars if you know any kids that want to come. So we will be doing that Wednesday. And I think that's it. So let's have a word of prayer, and then we will have the lighting of the Advent wreath. Let us pray. Father God, it is a joy to be in the house of the Lord, and we are just so thankful this fourth Sunday of Advent, that in the preparation that we have been going through. And so, Father, I just pray that those who are joining with us at home have been able to take and apply some of these, the things that we've been looking at during these four Sundays of Advent. And it's much more, it's just different this year than it has been in the past. But it's still, we're able to gather because of Facebook Live and YouTube, and we're still able to worship God. We're still able to hear the message. And so we're very thankful for that. But Father, we just ask that this very moment, that our minds can just be free of the clutter of the week and even the Christmas preparation, that we can just be filled with the Word of God, that we can just hear the music and hear the Word of God and hear the message for us today and be able to take and apply that to our life. And it's just, Christmas is not ruined. Christmas is just going to be different. And so if we truly begin to focus on you, if we truly begin to listen to you, then we can make Christmas just the way it's supposed to be. It's about building our relationship with Christ. It's about understanding what God has done for us. It is about just great things that God is doing. And so, Father, just help us to look at our lives, look at the church, look at who we are, and just truly be able to admire and to worship our God this Christmas. That's what Christmas is all about. And so this should be a great time to be able to just tune out the Christmas of the business type of Christmas and truly focus on the Christmas and our relationship in Christ. So Father, we thank you and praise you for this time together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We live on the brink every day. We stand on the threshold between this world and the next one. We live and move between the ordinary and divine, between the mundane and the mystery. Too often, we forget to look up and see the angels in our living room. We forget that the love we give and live is a sign of eternity, God with us right now. We forget that company is coming.
Luke tells us that God's favor came to a girl, an ordinary girl. It might have been you or your daughter. It might have been the girl down the street or your grandchild. But the messenger of God came and greeted her and said, "The Lord is with you." What a gift and a promise. Emmanuel, God is with us.
We light these candles with peace in our hearts for the promise of proximity, the nearness of God. Even when we forget to listen, to lean into that presence, God is as close as our own breath. This, in a confused and confusing world, is a peace that passes all understanding. It is a peace that knows that company is coming.
O come, Emmanuel. Just like every other Sunday, just about, I always forget something, so that's a sign of my age. So we, just as a reminder, we do have the upper rooms here at the church, and they're at both churches, Tept and Nyman. So if you'd like to stop by there and grab one, you can get one of those at the church. So let's see. We're now going to come together in our call to worship. Shout for joy,
the Savior is coming.
Sing with gladness,
our darkness shall be turned to light.
Let every heart prepare a space.
Let every home make ready.
Let all the hungry be filled.
Let all the homeless be sheltered.
For a new day is dawning.
The world is being made new.
The Savior is coming.
Sing with joy.
Now we're going to be blessed with a special song from Frank Russell, who is going to be singing a song called Heaven's Child.
Good morning. The title of this song, as Pastor said, is Heaven's Child, but when you first hear that title, obviously you're thinking of Jesus, but I like where you listen to the words too, as you hear the words, it's Mary and Joseph and how they're feeling. You think about the fact that when we have a newborn baby and we look at it, we just are in wonder. Think about Mary and Joseph as they looked at it and saw the baby Jesus, and Mary is thinking about the fact that she was a virgin, and they think about the prophecies that Jesus was going to come, as if they were going to send a Savior, and that they're part of that. And all I could think of was Mary and Joseph just looking down and going, whoa, as to what they had. So,
it seemed almost impossible to think it could be true. But as she pondered in her heart, she knew this was heaven's child. This was heaven's child. In an earthen vessel, wrapped in glory, Joseph wept with wonder as Mary sweetly smiled, because they knew this was heaven's child. The angels must have missed him as they sang him to sleep, but they marveled of the promises this baby boy would keep. His father must have felt it was great sadness and great joy as he watched his little baby boy, 'cause this was heaven's child. This was heaven's child.
Thank you.
today's scripture reading comes, the first one comes from the Gospel of Luke, and we'll be reading from chapter 1, verses 26 to 38. And the birth of Jesus foretold, and this is where the angel Gabriel comes before Mary and talks about what's going to happen here. It says in verse 26 that God sent Gabriel to talk to Mary. So let us hear the word this morning. In the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored, the Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, you have found favor with God. You will be with child and give birth to a son, and you will give him the name of Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overcome you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age. And she was said to be barren, is in her sixth month. For nothing is impossible for God." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May it be to me as you have said." Then the angel left her. Let us pray. Father God, if only we could have the same response that Mary had. Let this be as you have said, "I am your servant." Father, we know that this takes listening. This takes understanding that God is in charge, that God is the most powerful, He is the most high. This is the Messiah who is coming, and His kingdom will rule forever. But far too many times we forget what His will is for our life, and how we should submit ourselves to His will. And in these changing times in our world, we need to truly be focused on what should be that of Mary's. "I am your servant. Let it be as you have said." In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This is, I think, at this time of year, you hear this scripture a lot, and maybe over and over. But if you go back to the reading, the Advent reading that David and Ann did, I think if you go back and think about this in a different perspective, I want you to kind of think about it. All right, we know Mary's response in all of this. The angel Gabriel came to Mary, and in the first response to her, he said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored, the Lord is with you." And she was greatly troubled, it tells us. And she was greatly troubled because she didn't even know what was expected of her at this time. It was just maybe the appearance of this angel, maybe it was whatever it may be, maybe it was just hearing that the Lord has found favor with you. Whatever it may be, it says that she was greatly troubled. So if we go back to the reading for Advent, excuse me, I want you to kind of think about it. What if it was your daughter? What if it was your granddaughter, your great-granddaughter that this happened to? Have you ever thought about it for a minute on how you might feel if your daughter, granddaughter, great-granddaughter came up to you and told you that the Lord had come to you and He had found favor in you and you were going to have a child, the Son of the Most High? Have you ever thought about what you might have thought? I think if we look at that in perspective, we might get a small picture of what maybe Mary and Joseph went through from that day there and on. Because of maybe the response you would have if this was your child that was to hear this. See, we try and understand so many times about Mary was greatly troubled, and then the angel Gabriel goes on to tell her about you have found favor with God, and how she was going to have a child, and all of this. We've heard about Mary's side of this, but I want you to kind of put yourself in that perspective for a moment. You as the mother, the father, the grandmother, grandfather, great-grandmother, great-grandfather, whatever it may be, and it was your child that has heard this, how would you feel? Would you be greatly troubled? Would you be thinking that she's nuts? I think we would. I think we would have the same response that Mary and everyone else had, even though we know the story, even though we've heard it over and over every Christmas, we've heard it over and over. I think this Christmas we need to look at ourselves. And that's what we've been doing this Advent season. We've been looking at the church, we've been looking at ourselves. We know that who is the church? We are the church. We've been doing all of this stuff. We looked at the mess. We got a crew to clean up the mess. And we decked the halls with Jesus. We did all of these things. We're all prepared. We're waiting. Today, we're waiting. He's waiting at the threshold. And so we see all these things. And so let's listen to God. Because God has found favor in his people. But if we don't listen, and we will have no sense of direction for where God is leading us. Let us pray. Father God, we are your people. We are the people of God. We come to church and we hear the word, and we gather together and we support each other. And you have found favor with the things that we are doing. But Father, we know that we are also a society in disarray. And we're caught up in things aren't going to be the same as they've always been. And instead of being caught up in those kind of things, what we should be really doing is focusing on you and your direction that you have for each one of us. And so, Father, let us take this Advent season as we examine ourselves this fourth Sunday of Advent. And we know, Father, that you are just standing right there on the other side of the door. The preparations have been made, but now we need to look around the room. Is it really time to open up the door? Is it really time to open the door and welcome you in? Have we really made the right preparations? So, Father, today is still a day of examination. It's still a Sunday of preparation. But you're standing right there on the other side of the door. So, Father, let us truly and truthfully look at our lives and just see how we would respond if the angel Gabriel approached our child. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, now is the time of our prayer, and we're going to come together in prayer. So if anyone has any prayer requests at home, you can hopefully you put those in. David?
Susie asks prayers for Mama Jane and her church family, Brandon, Sandra, Lily, Josh, Nicole, Isabel, Brendan, and Maddie.
Thank you. Also, Jane Young, who's been writing her letters to the church and been watching online, and specifically this week, I want to lift up Jane and her church. She's a part of a smaller church. I don't really know the name of it. I don't remember. But she shared it with me before. But someone broke into their church this week and took a lot of their video and sound equipment out of the church. And so we just want to lift up their Jane's church, and that God just finds a way to replenish those things that have been taken so that they can continue to their online services too. So our hearts and prayers are with Jane Young and her church this week as they deal with that. So just a sad thing. So also pray our family altar Pray for our nation, elected officials, law enforcement, first responders, armed forces, teachers, school staff, and administration, healthcare workers, caregivers, and those affected by COVID, all churches and all God's children. Also, we want to be in prayer for those who have lost loved ones. I've heard a couple of different families this week that have lost loved ones to COVID. And so we want to continue to be with all of them. And also we want to be with all churches, meaning the decisions that need to be made about online only, you know, in-church services and all that kind of stuff. We need to listen for God's direction for all of us. And I really think I want to throw this out, not to be judgmental of any way that one church or another worships. Just pray that everyone's being led by God's guidance. David?
Susie said, I know I'll probably get this wrong, mispronounce it. Dahinda Methodist Church?
Dahinda?
D-A-H-I-N-D-A. Or she spelled it wrong.
Yeah. I don't know. We're in prayer for James Church. Frank?
Betty sends in for the Chandler family needs prayers.
Chandler family. So there's a lot of people in need of prayer. So we have some joys and birthdays and anniversaries this week, but also a lot of prayer. Also, we want to be in prayer for the nursing homes. I saw the news. I won't get it right. I don't remember, but there was like a home for nuns, and they lost, I think it was nine retired nuns to COVID. And I can't remember exactly. I want to think it was in Wisconsin. I don't know if anybody heard of it. I can be for either way. It was a retirement home for nuns, and I think it was nine nuns passed away of COVID. So, but that's happening through a lot of the nursing homes and stuff. So we want to remember the caregivers and nurses and doctors and our nursing home facilities. So let us pray. Father God, we just kind of stumble through our prayers, but Father, we know that through the gift of the Holy Spirit and the power of God that is at work within us, that you intercede in our prayers. So we are very thankful for that. But Father, you know the hurt and the sorrow that is going on in our hearts. So Father, we just pray to you this day that you will just hear our prayers as we intend them to be. And we know there is a great struggle in many families who have lost loved ones and those who are continuing to fight this battle of illness and even accidents and whatever it may be that are going on. And we know that many hospitals all around our areas are full to capacity in caring for loved ones. And so we want to continue to lift up the doctors and the nurses and the stress that they are under and caring for all of these. So Father, in all of this, that's why we do our part. And so Father, we just lift all of those situations up to you. We lift up the names of each and every person that was mentioned here this morning up to you. And we are just truly thankful that we can come to you in prayer. So Father, as we come before you as the people of God, we just truly want to begin to listen and for your guidance and for the Holy Spirit to lead us through these different trials that are coming up. And it's not about Christmas is ruined. It's not about any of that at all. It's about taking it maybe to the next level and changing. Christmas is definitely different from when I was a child. And is it worse now? No, it was good. So maybe you just have to just put your minds together and just come up with a better way of focusing on the true meaning of Christmas. And so, Father, that's what we want to do today. That's what we want to do in our Advent preparation, is that we want to truly focus on Christmas in a different way. And that means truly focus on the coming Messiah. And so, Father, we just thank you and praise you this day for for the opportunity to come into conversation and to lift up in prayer the hurts and the sorrows and the joys of our lives. So Father, as your disciples come together in prayer, let us hear one voice as we lift up the prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Also, let's see, our scripture lesson for today comes from 2 Samuel. And I just really enjoyed, I didn't remember reading this before, but the way my Bible is all marked up, I know I did, I had read it before, and but it's been a while, and I think what we need to do is kind of listen that David thought he was doing the right thing, and even Nathan kind of told him, you know, God is with you, so if that's what you hear, then go ahead and do it, and how that kind of turned around. So I think that's what we're going to listen for today, is that, you know, God is with us, and God is leading us, but sometimes we need to just kind of step back for a moment and look at what God is telling us. And if we look at that, are we truly following what God has called us to do? So our reading comes from 2 Samuel chapter 7 and verses 1 through 11, and then we'll jump to 16. After the king was settled in his palace, and the Lord had given him rest from all of his enemies around him, he said to Nathan the prophet, "Here I am living in a palace of cedar, while the ark of God remains in a tent." Nathan replied to the king, "Whatever you have in mind, go ahead and do it, for the Lord is with you." That night the word of the Lord came to Nathan, saying, "Go and tell my servant David, this is what the Lord says. Are you the one to build me a house to dwell in? I have not dwelt in a house from the day I brought the Israelites up out of Egypt to this day. I have been moving from place to place with a tent as my dwelling. Wherever I have moved with all the Israelites, did I ever say to any of their rulers, whom I commanded to shepherd my people Israel, why have you not built me a house of cedar? Now then, tell my servant David, this is what the Lord Almighty says. I took you from the pasture and from following the flock to be ruler over my people Israel. I have been with you wherever you have gone, and I have cut off all your enemies from before you. Now I will make your name great, like the names of the greatest men on earth. And I will provide a place for my people Israel and will plant them so that they can have a home of their own and no longer be disturbed. Wicked people will not oppress them anymore as they did at the beginning and have done ever since the time I appointed leaders over my people Israel. I will also give you rest from all your enemies." And then verse 16, "Your house and your kingdom will endure forever before me. Your throne will be established forever." Perfect. That's all right. I blew it. Let's pray. Father God, let us hear the message of David. From 2 Samuel, let us hear how David really thought he was doing a great thing, and providing. I think what he really saw is how much better he had it than what God had it. And so let us hear the message of God for us this day about how we can look at this scripture and examine our Christmas. Are we truly filled with the true meaning of Christmas? Are we truly filled with the welcoming of the Messiah? Does our home and our church reflect that of the message of Christmas. So, Father, we thank you and praise you for this story of David and how we can examine our own lives. So, Father, as we come before you, may you open up our hearts and our minds to receive the glory of your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. But we have all that. When I look at that and I hear those words, I kind of think, we just want to be comfortable in the church. He goes on and says, who won't wake us from our dreams. I think we need to be woke up. I think we need to be challenged. I think this Advent season is a time for us to do these things. And we need to take a look at everything that we've been doing all the way through this fourth Sunday of Advent and see what truly God is calling us to do. And I think what this passage is taught, or this part of the song is talking about, is that we want to be comfortable. In the first part of Samuel, it talked about how David was sitting in the palace and he's sitting there looking back. And I just kind of got this picture of David kind of kicked back in the throne of Lazy Boy. And he's kind of looking out the window and he's looking out there and he sees this tent outside. And he sees this tent and he knows that the Ark of the Covenant is stored inside this tent. And he has this revelation for a moment. And this revelation is that he's sitting in a palace of cedar, comfortable in his throne of Lazy Boy, and looking out the window, and there's God sitting outside in a tent in the Ark of the Covenant. Now, the Ark of the Covenant is what they believe that God himself was in place. And the scripture tells us today that the Ark was carried with them ever since the people left Israel, when God set them free. And so God was carried with them everywhere they went, and this tent was set up over the Ark of the Covenant. And so now David is sitting in a palace of cedar, it tells us, and he's looking out the window, and he sees this tent, and then he knows that it houses God, the Ark of the Covenant, and all of a sudden he has this, I need to build a temple of cedar, stone. It's just not right that I would be in this palace and God himself is out there in a tent. Just something doesn't seem right to David. And Nathan tells him, he says, if you're a person of God, and if this is what you feel, then you need to do this. This is what you need to do. You're on the right track. Nathan is a prophet. David probably took this as words of encouragement. I just picture David kind of sitting there thinking, I need to start working on these plans. I need to start making provisions and getting everything together. We need to build this temple for God. I need to at least be able to sit in my palace of cedar and have God in something similar to me. It's just not right that God is sitting in a tent and I'm kicked back in my Lazy Boy throne. So he wants to justify these things. He's in a place of comfort. And so if we take a look at the church, according to the song, my new favorite song, it starts right here. In other words, it starts with the people of God. It starts right here in the church. It starts right here in our home. It starts with what God is leading us to do. And even though we are like David, and we can sit there and look at our homes, and we can look at where we live, we can look at all the decorations, we can look at all these things, I want you to kind of take it a step farther. Have you ever looked out the window and just truly examined for a moment, where is God in your life? In other words, are you sitting in a palace of cedar and looking out the window and God is in a tent outside in your yard? See, I think that's a message for all of us in this, as people of God. God has provided for us. David is sitting there relaxing because God is giving him rest. And the reason he's giving him rest, if you look in chapter 8, it talks about in there about the victories that David had. Now these victories, even though they're in chapter 8, we're in chapter 7, these victories happened prior to this time where David is sitting in the palace. And so if you look at the chronological order and that kind of thing, these victories came before this time. And so David is sitting there and he is relaxing because God is giving him rest after all these victories and these battles where God had conquered his foes and his enemies. And so he is kicked back and he is resting from all of this. And so he has been blessed by God. So I think Christmas is a great time for us, this Advent season is a time for us to kind of kick back in our homes, in our Lazy Boy, on our couch, our foot up on the ottoman, and look out the window and just kind of think to ourselves, is God in a tent outside in our yard while we are sitting in our palace, whatever your palace may be, are we sitting in our palace comfortable and relaxed with our feet up, enjoying the blessings of God? Whatever the victories, we don't have the same battles that David had and the enemies that David had, but we have victories. And I would like to even change that for you and I, the blessings of God. And so if we look at the blessings that God has blessed each one of us with, and we're sitting in our palace with our feet up, are we looking outside and God is in a tent? Advent should have been a time where we realize this. And I think sometimes that our response would be that of the same as David. Well, I need to build him a temple. Whatever that may be. Maybe a Christmas tree, like what we have here, with all these different chrismons on it and these symbols. In other words, there is nothing wrong, and I'm not talking, I love Santa to death. And I love all the decorations, and I love all of that stuff. And I think they very much have a part of our Christmas the way it is today. But is our Christmas, last week I talked about decking the halls with Jesus, is our Christmas that of balance with the blessings that God has given us? In other words, I guess I could suggest this, but do we have a tree decorated with the chrismons and all the symbols of God and you know the symbols and the fish and all these different things? Do we have it? We can have a tree like that dedicated to the true meaning of Christmas. But I also love the garland and the lights and all that kind of stuff. It very much has a purpose in our lives. Both of these things have a purpose. But what we cannot do is have a palace decorated with the Christmas the Christmas of the business world, so to speak, and not have the true meaning of Christmas, which is that of the coming Messiah. And so I think this is a great time for us to kind of examine that self and maybe put that, is God in a tent outside in our front yard or our backyard? Has he taken second place? I think that's what we should look at. And then in this here, I think one of the other lines that kind of caught me is that we want to see our hearts set free, but we want the tyrants to kneel. And I think that's very important in this psalm, because I think it's very true. Talk about we want our blessings in a pocket. In other words, we can pull out a blessing whenever we need it. You know, I'm going through a really time, I need to be blessed, so I reach in my pocket and I pull it out. That's how I kind of see this psalm. We want our hearts to be healed. We want our hearts to be set free. But yet, those out there, the tyrants, we want to see them kneel before God. But I think the true meaning of Christmas, the true meaning of Advent, means that we are the ones to kneel. We are the ones to kneel before Jesus. We are the ones to kneel before the Messiah who is coming. And going with today's message, we are the ones who need to kneel, because he is waiting at the threshold. So think about that for a moment. Where are we in our celebration of Christmas? The song says, it starts right here. And that's exactly the truth. It starts right here in the church. It starts right here in the people of God. It starts right here in coming together as the people of God. This is my new favorite song, because it is a very powerful message for all of us, is that it starts right here. It's not something you or I point to someone else to begin. It starts right here with me and with you. Let me ask you a question. Have you ever, I don't know if you've ever seen a hawk or an eagle, I don't see too many eagles when I'm kind of sitting out in the trees or anything. But have you ever seen a hawk out there in flight in the natural, in the woods or something like that? I think it's just picturesque. It's just beautiful. First of all, they just kind of blend in with the surroundings so much that if you don't see them move or land or take off or something, you wouldn't even know that they're there. They just kind of sit there and just survey and they just look out over it. And I think the owl is much of the same thing. An owl is just so, just very much that you don't see them very often, that when you do, it just seems so rare and so awe-spoken. But if you've ever seen an owl or a hawk fly through the trees, it's just beautiful on how they just can go through all the trees and the branches and the leaves and everything, and they just kind of glide through there and turn and not hit a single thing. I mean, it's just very beautiful to see this going through the trees. Now, on the other hand, a turkey, I got news for you. A turkey, if you've ever seen it, that thing's a klutz. That thing is like a lineman going through the, hitting everything and anything that's going through the. They make more racket going in and out of the roosting in the trees than you could ever. I mean, it would cover up any sound that, you know, someone would make out there. And they're very klutzy, I've seen them go up into the roost, and then you just hear, you know, the wings flapping and hitting every branch on the way up there. And then you hear them coming out of the roost, and they just make all kinds of racket, hitting every branch. They just, you know, it just reminded me of the old cartoon back in the late 60s of Super Chicken. I don't know if you've ever seen Super Chicken, the cartoon, is that he just kind of flies down and kind of crashes when he lands. He really can't fly at all. And so it just, a turkey is very klutzy in what he does, but they're very optimistic. Recently got to watch a turkey roost in a tree, and the turkey took off from the ground and flies up there and tries to land on the tiniest of branch. Here you got about a 25, 30 pound bird, flies up there and lands on this little branch, and all of a sudden I just see the branch start to go like this. And it begins to drop like that, and all of a sudden the turkey, who was very optimistic at the moment, and landing on that branch, starts flapping his wings and ends up going all the way back down to the ground. Can't even go to the next branch, but it ends up falling all the way back to the ground and kind of lands and makes all this noise and then just sits there for a little while. And then next thing you see, flies back up there, crashing into everything until he gets to a tree and he lands on a branch and he sits up there for the rest of the night. They're very klutzy, but they're optimistic that branch would hold them. During this pandemic, I think that the church, the greater church as a whole, has been much like the turkey. We're very optimistic. We're going to do the best that we can. We're going to do whatever we can to bring the message of God to those in our homes, to keep everybody safe. But I think the greater church has become like that turkey, and we're very klutzy in trying to come up with ways to still have church. We have some churches that say, I'm not going to let this pandemic or anybody ruin my Christmas. We're going to meet anyway. We have other people that say, I'm not going to wear a mask, or we're going to wear a mask. Other people who come together, other churches come together, like our conference has said, we are recommending that the churches close and do online services only. For two reasons: to protect those of the congregation coming together, but also to help the doctors and the nurses and the influx of patients from COVID. And I think this is kind of a great message, and it's kind of what I believe. Is it different? It definitely is different. Is it a different way of worshiping? Yes, definitely is. But I think the way that we get through this, and the way that we don't become like the turkey, is that we listen to God. Are we still reaching out into the community and bringing God to the people? And yes, we are. I don't think that we should be looking at the church in a sense and taking a stronghold to say, I'm not going to let someone tell me what to do. I think what we need to do is to listen to God. What is He calling? And I know that we in the church, in many churches, there are people who are at risk. And I think taking the proper steps to protect them, whatever that may be, and if I don't feel it is a great inconvenience, but if you feel that it's an inconvenience to you, it just might be a blessing to someone else. So I think what we need to do is just to truly focus on what God is calling us to do. Christmas is definitely going to be different. In our house, you know, we usually have a Christmas at our house. All the kids come over, and the grandkids, and we have a very small house, and everybody kind of gets together. We've kind of decided that we're going to take and have Christmas at one of my son's house, and we'll kind of go there in different stages and kind of keep separated and just be prepared for all the stuff, and Christmas is going to be different. But I think that we've kind of come up with a way to make it similar or to make it seem the same to some of the kids. And so I think that's what we need to do in the church, is that we need to continue to bring the message of God and to listen to him. See, Nathan went home that night, and he's a prophet. He listened to the word of God. He went there thinking that David was on the right track. If God is telling you, if God is with you, you build this temple. You build this temple of cedar. And so he goes home thinking that David is doing all the right things. And he takes and gets home, and all of a sudden God speaks to him, and he says, Nathan, that's not, and I'm paraphrasing, Nathan, that's not right. You know, if I wanted someone, I have had many leaders since I led the people out of Israel, or out of Egypt. There's been many leaders. If I wanted a palace made of cedar, wouldn't I have asked for that? But see, this is the message here for all of us, is that God, from the time of the Israelites left Egypt, that God was with them. God continued to be with them. And when David wanted to build a palace of cedar for God to be housed in, God says, if I wanted that, I would have asked for that. Did I ever once ask any of the leaders to build one of these palaces of cedar? No. He wanted to be with the people. And that's what the message of Christ is, that God wants to be with the people. God wants to be with you and I. God, excuse me, God is coming to be with you and I. Company is coming. That's the message for all of this. Company is coming, and today he is waiting on the threshold of your door. You have been preparing for the last 4 weeks for Christmas during this Advent season. We've looked around our home. We've looked around the church. We've seen the mess that has been gathered. We got a crew together, and we cleaned up that mess, and we prepared for that. We put up all the decorations, and we heard how we should deck the halls with that of Jesus. In other words, bringing the decorations of the commercialism of Christmas and also that of Jesus, how we put all that together. Are we ready to open the door for Jesus to come in? Remember, I look at it as like this. We've been looking at company is coming. But company is not coming anymore. The company is here. The company is standing right on the other side of the door. He's waiting at the threshold of your door. Are you ready to open the door? Have you got to the door and you've looked all around the house and you've seen, are you really prepared for the company to come in the door? Are you really prepared for what is to come? Are you really prepared for the Messiah? There's a message for us in the book of Luke when we hear about the story of Jesus. It said in there about the Son of the Most High. Mary is going to give birth to the Son of the Most High. How can this be? Because I'm a virgin. And the Holy Spirit will be poured out upon you. What? She hadn't heard of the Holy Spirit yet. The Holy Spirit hadn't come yet. But it was also a reference of that of the Messiah that has come. The power of God, it said. The power of God will come upon you. He has found favor of you, and the power of God is going to come upon you, and you are going to be with child. That's a messianic interpretation. The Messiah is coming, and his kingdom will reign forever, it says. Your throne will come, the descendant of David. Calls him the son of David. Mary and Joseph were both descendants of David. That's where this reference is, the father David. If you look in the scriptures, the father is a small F on there. It's not the capital F, meaning the Father in heaven. So he is the father of David. In other words, he is a descendant of David. See, all of this kind of works together. all of this comes together in our scripture today. It says that in Samuel, it says in verse 16, your house and your kingdom will endure forever. See, when I look at that, we're talking about this is a messianic interpretation, is the Messiah is coming. His kingdom will reign forever. Why is it we live in such fear in the church if his kingdom will reign forever? And the fear I'm talking about is whether we are doing right or wrong in the eyes of God. If we're listening to God, if we've made all the right preparations, if we've examined ourselves, we saw the mess, we cleaned it up, we've hung the decorations, we just can't wait for the company to come. But our nerves begin to maybe unravel. Because we've heard the knock at the door. Today, the fourth Sunday of Advent, Jesus is waiting on the threshold. He's waiting on the threshold of your home. He's waiting on the threshold of the church. He's waiting on the threshold of your life. Are you ready to open the door of all the proper decorations, of the proper cleaning of your home? Has all of that been prepared? Are you ready to reach down and grab the doorknob and open it up because you know the company has arrived? Let's pray. Father God, we just thank you and praise you this day that we serve a God who still loves us, who continues to love us no matter who we are or where we are or what we do. That you are a God that forgives us no matter what we do with our life. You give us an opportunity to turn things around. You give us an opportunity to travel the journey that you have placed us on, even when we go off the track. Father, you are a God that just loves us beyond all measure. And Father, we just know that it doesn't really matter whether our decorations are right or proper. What it really matters is that we have given ourselves to you. And so, Father, we just thank you and praise you this day for the glory of a God that loves us no matter what. And so, Father, we pray as a church, as the people of God, as the greater church all around, that we can embrace that same kind of love, that we can welcome each other into our homes with the expectation that God is coming through that door. The Messiah is coming. The King is coming. Let us shout, O come, Emmanuel. Let our hearts be open. Let our minds be prepared for the coming of the King. Father, God wants to be where we are. He doesn't want a palace of cedar. He wants to be where we are. And so wherever that is, whether our home is that of a living in a trailer or a rundown community or a big subdivision, whatever that may be, God just wants us to be prepared for the company that's coming. So let us look at the door, the threshold of our life and our homes and our churches. And as we reach down to open that door, knowing exactly who is waiting on the threshold, may we open that door, welcoming in the Messiah, the Son of God, the Son of the Most High. In Jesus' precious and holy name, we come together. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Facebook that somebody shared with me, and there's a man, little cartoon stick type of man is what I remember, standing there holding a heart in his hands. And there's Jesus standing there, and this little stick has those little words up above that said, "This is all I have." And Jesus says, "That's all I've ever asked for." That's all Jesus asked for, is for our hearts. May the peace of Christ be with you.
With you also.
Amen.